Hey, what is up, guys? Welcome back. So I decided to make another video, mainly because I just got my new mic and I'm really, really excited to be using it. So I decided to make a video where I mostly talk and stuff, just for the hell of it, really. So this is a video that I'm doing as a favor to the newer players that started playing Monster Super League recently and happened to find my channel. I've been getting some comments about people asking, like, hey, what should I do with this, like, A, B, and C monster? Or, where should I be farming to like, 6-star stuff and stuff? Like, just really, really basic stuff. But what I'm going to talk about here is my experiences in playing the game and how to basically, how to apply those and progress as fast as humanly possible. Take as many shortcuts as possible in the game. So, first things first, I do want to warn you guys, like, don't take progression too seriously, because when you take things, like, especially like in this game, when you take things too seriously, if you miss out on something, like you have horrible luck, you miss a rebirth or something like that for that month, you get really, really depressed and stuff. And I definitely don't want that happening to you guys. So a lot of the times I really just play for fun. Like, I 6-star random monsters that whenever I feel like. I always tell people to do as I say, not as I do, because I wouldn't really call them mistakes, but I just do whatever random shit that I feel like doing, honestly. So yeah, that's one thing. The other thing is you'll have, like, monsters that you'll favor and stuff. Maybe it's the design of the monster and stuff like that. You can definitely raise those monsters just for the hell of it. It was like that with my Dark Victoria. She didn't really help me all that much. I really liked this monster, so I decided to raise her just for the hell of it. But now she's going to be useful to me because I've actually found a use for her. So I decided recently to start seriously working on getting more fusions and trying to get her to Evil 3 and max her out as much as possible. So I don't really think any mistake that you make in the game isn't really going to be permanent, because you can always catch up in the future. So don't worry too much about that. Now, the first thing you want to do when you start playing the game, you'll have some random monsters like that Fire Miho, that Water Lat. You get those really, really early on in the game, and those are just monsters offered to you. What you want to do is your first objective in the game is to be clearing through most of the normal maps. The reason for this is when you clear through the normal maps, when you complete these, like, random quests, like clear stage one of something something, these story quests that you complete by going through each step, it gives you a copy of the monster that you can capture on these maps. So you're always guaranteed to at least get one Seedler, one Siren, one Candle, Coco. You'll always be guaranteed to get one of them. So you definitely want to do that, because some of these monsters are pretty good that you can use temporarily to help you through the early game. Because, like, if you get the Siren, you don't have a healer, you definitely need one healer to get through harder stages of dungeons, of story map, of if you start out on the Tower of Chaos or anything like that. You definitely want to get through as far as possible in everything. So a healer will definitely help you, because without a healer, you're basically going through the map trying to nuke things down, and you have, like, zero sustain. So when you get to, like, the third part of the stage, sometimes your monsters could be dead or whatever. So you definitely want to get through these maps and just collect one of each of these monsters. I'll talk a little bit about these monsters and how they could be useful to you for farming various dungeons. So after you get through the first map, your second most important objective is to get through extreme mode on Phantom Forest. you don't necessarily need to get through all of Extreme Mode. Technically, as long as you can farm Stage 1 of Extreme Mode, like you can get through Stage 1 of Extreme Mode stably every single time, then that's pretty much good enough. Because the reason you want to do this is to get access to these gems. It doesn't really matter which set you're using. The flat stats are almost as good as the percent stats when you're only using 4-star gems. So as long as you can clear through the first map of Phantom Forest on Extreme Mode, you will have access to 4-star gems. They're going to be the Tenacity set, which gives you bonus health. All monsters need health, so this is definitely somewhat useful early on. So once you're able to clear through it, what you want to work on is you want to work on mostly wood monsters. So this is going to be your next big project after you're able to complete your second objective, which is to get through Phantom Forest on Extreme Mode. You definitely want to be able to like farm through the whole map, because you don't really want to waste your resources farming the first map, because the first map only gives you fruits. If you can, try to farm on the fifth map, which gives you EXP bonus when you're farming and leveling your monsters. It just kind of saves you a little bit of resources. It's a little bit more efficient to be farming this map instead of the first map, because although the fruits can help you level really fast, they also cost gold for you to use. So it's a little bit, it's a double-edged sword, basically. So as long as you can clear through the first map, it's good enough, because you will be able to have access to the gems, and you'll eventually, once you get your main team like fully gemmed with 4-star gems and get them all the gems to plus 12, then you should be able to clear through probably all the way to maybe this map or so. But the reason you want to do this is to eventually start moving on into the Golem Dungeons. The Golem Dungeon is where all the really, really good gems are. Like you'll start getting access. If you can farm B7 and above, you'll have access to 4-star to 6-star gems. So this is like where you actually have access to like the very, very high-end gems, which are 6-star. This is going to be your kind of like your first like really, really big goalpost. If you can complete this, then you're in a really, really good position already. So if you can get to Golems B7, you're going to be in a really, really good position. But before you can get into B7, there's a few things you need to work on. Just keep this as a standard for like the power level of your monsters. If you can get a full team of all wood monsters, all 4-stars need to be at least Evil 2, and all 3-stars need to be Evil 3, and get them fully gemmed up with 4-star gems, so you can get like random 4-star gems here. Get them fully gemmed up with 4-star gems and raise them to 5-stars max level. You should be able to clear through Golems B7. B7 isn't really all that hard. You can pretty much do with any 4 wood monsters as long as one of them is a healer. Like, I mean that literally. Like, you can throw in any 4 wood monsters as long as one of them is a healer, and you will be able to clear through Golems B7. The requirement isn't all that high. As long as you have all 3-star monsters need to be at least Evil 3, and all 4-star monsters need to be at least Evil 2. And if you can achieve this, then it's going to be pretty good. Another thing I think a lot of newer players don't realize is how strong Evil 3 monsters are. Like Evil 3 monsters are a lot stronger than Evil 2. So if you have like a 3-star Evil 3 monster, a lot of the times it's going to be stronger than an Evil 2 4-star monster. So we'll take like 2 random whatever monsters. I mean, tank, attacker. What's a good wood monster that I would recommend using for golems? Like, actually, any of these are pretty good. Wild Thing's pretty good. Hana's really good. I was looking for Banshee. Oh yeah, the Banshee's right here. This is like one of the best wood monsters. She has really, really good skills. So if you get her to 5-stars max level at Evil 2, she has almost 20k HP, almost 2k attack and 1300 defense, so 1.3k defense. So if you have any like random wood monsters, say for example this Kokomon, and you have him at evil 3 5 stars, you can see that his stats are actually you know, like these two stats are on par with the Banshee, and his HP is actually even higher. You'll see this on a lot of other monsters as well. You know, if you can, oh wait, no, this one's only evil 2. Like, if you can get it to evil 3, like, this one's a tank, and it's really, really tanky. Like, although the attack and defense are really low, the HP is much, much higher. So, a lot of the times, using 3-star, like, evil 3-star monsters could be better than using 4-star, evil 2 4-star monsters. But it's not always the case, because monsters have different stats. Like, all monsters have various stats. But another really good thing about using evil 3-star monsters is it's easier to get monsters to evil 3. You don't have to use any gleams or anything like that, because gleams are like a limited resource. But these Mihos are basically farmable on every single map, so as long as you just keep farming enough, you'll eventually get a 3-star Miho. And a wood Miho is a really, really good monster that you can use for Golems B7. If you farm enough Mihos, you'll definitely get some variants. Her variant skill gives you resistance, which is usable like everywhere, so if you don't have a better leader skill, you can always put her as leader, and it's going to be good enough. That's just one of my recommendations to you guys for Golems B7. Like, if you're at the stage where you're farming Golems B7, don't overlook 3-star monsters, especially some of them being farmable and also you know, given to you for free. Like the Seedler is really good. The Seedler provides sap, and sap is pretty good early on, because the good thing about sap is you can, on sap monsters, sap reduce the enemy's max HP by 5% each time you land a sap on the enemy. Whenever he gets a turn, he loses 5% of his max HP. The reason why this is good is because sappers actually give you some sort of damage. Like, they give you damage, and they're not required to have any other stats besides tankiness. So you can make them as tanky as possible, and they'll still be able to provide consistent damage through their saps. So, like, the Seedler is definitely a really, really good monster for if you're starting Golems B7, you want a really stable team. And also, like, monsters like the Coco, he's also relatively decent. He's got stun and sap. I don't really think the stun's that useful, but then he's also an attacker at the same time. And if you can get him as a variant, then he gives all wood monsters extra attack. So if you're running like a full wood team, he's definitely a really good monster that you can put as your leader or whatever. But there's also other good monsters, like you know, the Monas. Water Monas are farmable, and you can summon wood Monas if you're like somewhat lucky. It's not too hard to summon a wood Mona, and Monas also give extra attack to its element. So water gives extra attack to water, wood gives extra attack to wood. So if you have like a wood Mona, you can definitely use that as well. You want to just look at whichever monster is easier to raise to evil 3. You don't technically need the monster to be farmable. Like, you don't need that exact monster to be farmable, because it's not too difficult to summon, you know, with the example of the wood Mona, it's not too difficult to summon a wood Mona. And if you do happen to summon one, you can get it to evil 3 relatively easily by farming this map for the water Monas. But that being said, you don't need any, you can literally do it with all farmable monsters. So you can literally just put the wood Kokomon as leader, and then put in a Seedler, put in a Beth, put in a Miho, like one of those three. Like, they're all farmable, and like one healer. And there are some pretty good wood healers as well. Like, even some 2-star healers are relatively decent to use temporarily just to progress through Golems B7. There's the Wood Siren. She has Wood Siren's all right. Like, she's not super, super good. I think a better one is like, now Wood Mini Cat's a little bit hard to get to evil 3. So I think like two star wood monsters, the Coteen. This one's pretty decent. Actually, wait, no. I don't really know too much about the two stars. I know I remember some of them being pretty good. I think these ones are farmable, right? This one's got stun and vigor. Vigor is quite strong. Vigor is quite a strong healing skill, because it gives you heal over time after it heals. But I think the Rabonis aren't farmable. Oh, Shelly's, you can farm Shelly's here. Wait, I didn't get to Slumbery City. I haven't even done the last map. I just never got around to actually completing my story mode. Spent too much time farming golems and stuff. But I think the Cotine is probably the easiest to get to Evil 3, because they're 2 stars, so you can basically just keep capturing them on this map over here. Over this one, if I remember correctly. Yeah, there's Cotines here, so you can capture them really, really easily. And I mean, Wood Siren's pretty good too. Like, her, although her skills aren't that useful, it's still decent. It's definitely not bad. And you're only using these monsters temporarily, so they technically don't need to have like the best possible skills. But if you summon some wood healer like the Wood Hana, Wood Cupid, these are all really, really good monsters. Wood Kira's not that good. I mean, he's alright. He has Taunt, Purification. They're not really all that useful, but stat-wise, if you can get him to Evil 3 at max level, 5 stars max level, he at least has 2,500 attack, 1k defense. So he's still like, and he has really high recovery, so he's going to be healing quite a lot. So you basically just get his HP and get a little bit of defense on him to make him somewhat tanky, and then he'll be able to heal your team enough to sustain them and keep them alive. And that's all he really needs to do. Like, you don't need anything. You don't really need him for anything else. Just as long as he can keep your team alive, it's good enough. But there's like, mini cats aren't farmable. The Siren also, I think maybe her stats are good. She has a little bit lower HP, lower recovery, has slightly higher defense. She drops red souls when enemies drop blue souls, and she has recovery up. She probably might be the best one. I would probably recommend using her. Another good thing about using the Siren, if you happen to summon a Wood Siren, you can level them up with Water Sirens. And they also, if you happen to get one as a variant, you can get this leader skill, which increases the defense of all your monsters. I recommend using a defensive leader skill rather than an offensive one, but if you only have an offensive leader skill, then you can still use it as well. The reason for that is basically you just want to survive as long as you can, because as long as you can survive against the attacks of the boss, you'll eventually, you'll eventually kill him. So it's better to play safe first, like to make a stable team before you start working on, you know, making a faster team with more attackers and stuff. And I think that's pretty much it for Golems B7. You can get through it relatively easily with all farmable monsters. You don't need any 4 stars for this. And as soon as you're able to clear through B7, you have a lot of potential to get a lot more gold. And you want to farm these gems and just sell them to get gold. Like, if you farm like gems that you don't need, you can sell them for gold. And the good thing, like, there's a little trick about getting through B8 and B9 if you're only able to farm B7, and that is to use mostly monsters that have these diamond slot gems, because B7 is a lot easier than B8 and B9. So if you use mostly diamond slot gems, then you can basically gem a monster up with really, really good gems just by farming Golems B7 and nothing else. So if you, for example, if you had a monster with only 3 diamond gems, and that monster only, like, I don't think, with the exception of monsters that, like, definitely, like, attackers that definitely require crit, any monster like that will definitely be usable. You can basically build them all hybrid. So, like, if it's like a utility monster and happens to have like 3 diamond slots, then you can put HP, defense, attack. You can gem all monsters up like that, and yeah, eventually you'll be able to move on to B8 and B9. So there's also another thing I should probably tell you guys. B9 is actually easier than B8. Like, B9 literally is easier to farm than B8. The reason for that is because B8 is light, and light-based like monsters are only weak against dark monsters, but dark monsters are just as weak against light monsters. So basically, while dark monsters are attacking light monsters, they always have the attack advantage over each other, which means they're always going to be doing like lots of damage against each other. So there's no rock paper scissors phenomenon here. You know, I did, like, if I was talking about wood monsters, like why I'm using wood monsters for B7, it's because B7 is water, and water is weak against wood. So you can abuse the elemental advantage that you have against the boss by using monsters of the same element. But you're not able to do that in B8 because he's light based. But you're able to do that in B9 since he's wood. So as long as you stack a full team of fire monsters, you'll have a lot of advantage over against this boss. So after B7, I think the next stage is to start working on B8, monsters for B8. B8, there's multiple ways to do it. My biggest recommendation would probably be to use lots of sustain. Like, sustain is definitely the way to go against this boss. The reason for that is he has sap, which is really, really annoying. Like, he lands a lot of sap on your units. So he doesn't do a lot of damage against your units, but what he does instead is he stacks all these saps on your units to slowly wither them down. So if you don't have enough sustain against this boss, then you'll eventually at some point die. The best units to use against the B7 boss, if you happen to have them, probably at this point you probably would have done your summoning a few times. The best of the best units, I think, like my biggest recommendation for against this boss would be units with self-sustain. Any unit that has some sort of skill that allows them to heal whenever they attack. So monsters like the Fire Wild Fang, who has like basically HP Siphon or Adrenaline, so attacks that restore HP based on damage dealt, is very, very strong against this boss. So units like the Fire Wild Fang, the Fire Vampire. Can't remember. I think I do have a Fire Vampire somewhere. I lost him. He heals for 50% when he crits. And then there's the Fire Succubus. She also has HP Siphon only when she crits. The problem with the Fire Vampire and the Fire Succubus is they're required to crit, so it's a little bit harder to gem them up, because you probably want to have a square slot on them, and you can't farm B8 because B8 is harder than B9. So the only way you can get some square slot crit rate gems is if you go back and farm B5, which is kind of a waste of time if you think about it. So I think that my highest recommendation would still be the Fire Wild Fang, because she doesn't require any sort of crit, so you can basically just build attack, like double attack defense or something like that, and she can sustain pretty well. Another trick is to use more healers. So I've seen some people do this before. You can do something like using two fire sirens. So the thing with the fire sirens is they have some sort of sustain. Like, they're healers basically. Like, I was gonna click into monsters. So like, the fire sirens are healers that have sustain. Where the fuck are they? They're healers that have sustain, and they have they're also able to sap with their first skill. So basically, you build them really tanky, and with their healing skill, you can sustain against the boss. And whenever you take damage, you gain more SP bar, so you heal more. And then they also have that nice defensive leader skill that you can use for all your fire monsters. So you can just basically, Like if you're super unlucky, you can literally stack four fire sirens and you can farm B9. But I definitely don't recommend that. It's not that difficult to farm B9, as long as you're able to have some decent gems from farming B7, and you happen to have a few pretty good monsters that you can use, like the Wild Fang, Succubus, or Vampire, or I don't know if you guys did the Venus thing. The Venus is pretty good as well. Another really good thing I was going to mention right after talking about self-sustain is Shield is very, very strong against B7, because Shield has two effects. Shield does not only block out damage. Before a shield is broken, before a shield is broken, you don't take any sort of debuffs. So the boss is not able to land sap on your units while you have a shield up. So that makes monsters like the Fire Cura very, very strong, because she happens to be fire, and she's also a shield-based healer. So you can basically protect your team with a shield, so the boss is not able to land sap on your team, and you sustain. You basically just sustain your team. But you can use any shield-based healer, like the Wood Cupid, if you happen to have him. He's also very, very good as well. He's wood, so he's neutral against wood, so you don't have to worry too much about like being at a elemental disadvantage. He's neutral with the wood boss, so he might require a little bit more tankiness than your other fire monsters, so you can invest in his gems a little bit more since his element's neutral. But he has very, very good skills as well. He has this, which can give you your team more blue souls, and he has a shield that can help your team sustain. So if you happen to have him and before you start working on B7, you can definitely raise him, and once you get into B9, you can continue using him. So he's definitely a really, really good monster to invest in if you happen to have him. There was the Venus fusion event, which just ended recently. She also has shield, a very, very good shield, and she also has self-sustain, so she's basically perfect for B9 if you happen to have her. She's like self-sustain plus shield, so yeah, but she was in an event, so if you guys happen to have been playing for the past few weeks and happen to have done the event and fused her, then you know that's really, really good news. But if you don't, it's still okay. Like, you don't really require anything too hard to farm B7. Like, you can literally just stack four healers and you'll be able to farm B7. It's not that difficult. Like, you don't even need to use the siren, you can use like the Coteen or something like that, or the Ruboni. They're all pretty good monsters that you can use. And then yeah, you can do that and farm B9. I was just looking at some other fire monsters that have sustain, but there's not that many. I mean, you could use like two nukers, and then you stack two healers, and then this way you can sustain through the boss's damage. So that's kind of it for B7. Moving on to B8 after B or not B B7 B9. B8 is actually harder than B9, as I mentioned before. So after you're able to farm B9, you have access to triangle gems. You can start using those gems to start farming B8. And B8, the thing about the B8 boss is he has some very, very strong like offensive skills. He's basically a glass cannon. He has high attack stats and low defense. Like, he's basically just he hits hard, but he also dies really fast. So the most ideal way to fight against him is to kill him before he kills you. Like, you want to nuke him really, really hard, but you don't want to go like full nuke. So most monsters, like if you're at the stage where you're able to farm B7 and B9, but you're not able to, you're moving on to B8, you should probably gem most of your monsters with like one defensive gem, like either defense or HP, and do like defense crit rate attack or defense double attack or something like that, depending on their element. A good idea is if you happen to be doing like rebirths and stuff, a lot of the like dark monsters are actually quite good against this boss, because most of the time you're able to kill the other units before they kill you. So you're kind of rewarded more since you have the first move. You're kind of rewarded more for using the dark elemental advantage against light. So there's quite a few rebirth monsters. There's always rebirth monsters every single month. If you're watching this video at the time when I just released it, then there's two monsters that are coming out for the next month's rebirth. They're adding into the pool. So there's the Dark Monkey, which is really good. This over here. This guy is a defense aggressor. So what this means is you can put high defense on him, and he will be able to hit relatively hard. He'll be able to do lots of damage. He also has a nice leader skill that you can use to basically get even more damage, and damage is what you want against the B8 boss. So this is definitely a really good unit you can use if you get him next month. He's going to be available tomorrow once the new rebirth pool comes out. And they're also saying that they're planning to add the Dark Sea Star into the rebirth pool. So she was a previous rebirth monster from a long, long time ago. I have her as well. She's also a defense aggressor. You stack defense on her, she hits hard, and this is perfect, basically. So dark defense aggressors are definitely really, really good for B8. And these types of monsters are also very, very good for B10. So, you know, when they come out, when they're available next month, definitely try to grab them, you know. Yes, I think that's pretty much it for B8. There's not too much for me to talk about. You can use any nukers. Like, it doesn't even have to be dark. When I first started farming B8, I was using the Fire Arthur, Fired Wild Thing. I had a Dark Cupid, which is a shield healer, but you don't really need to use the Dark Cupid. If you have, like, the Light Venus, you know, a Wood Cupid, you can use that as well. I think shields are definitely the best heals you can have in the game. You know, shields are really, really good. So, unfortunately, not a lot of monsters have shield, but there are a few, like the Fire Cura. If you were using the Fire Cura for B9, you can continue using the Fire Cura for B8 as well. So she's still going to be really, really good. You don't need to really worry too much about elements, but I do recommend using, like, if you can put together like a mostly dark team. You should definitely use the dark advantage against the light boss. So that's pretty much it for B8. Moving on, we're going to move on to B10. Now, B10 is much, much harder than B7, 8, 9. It's just, like, there's a huge level gap here. The thing is, the B10 boss isn't all that difficult to kill. He's really annoying because he has silence. So if this happens to land on one of your units at the wrong time, it can actually screw your run-up really, really badly. The best thing to use against B10 is actually passive healers, but there's not that many in the game. And they're also not available anymore. The one I use is the Dark July, which was available for Rebirth quite a while ago. It was a few months ago. What I mean by passive healers is monsters that have some sort of heal that is tied to their attacks, basically. So what this does is it means you're able to heal back any sort of HP, making sure that most of the time of your monsters are at full HP. You know, it just makes sure, it just gives you like another layer of safety net to you know, make sure nothing bad goes wrong. Like, you don't get silenced at the wrong time. You don't enter the one stage with like not max HP and happen to get killed by nukes, and then eventually get killed by the boss since you only have 3 units left. You know, stuff like that. There's a few monsters that are pretty good for B10. Besides passive healers, there are some active healers that are pretty good. Like the Light Venus is very, very good for B10. The way that Light Venus's AI works is she works a little bit different from other healers. She basically always uses her heal whenever it's up. So this is like an advantage over the other healers. It makes sure that she's able to provide this shield, which kind of reduces a lot of other, like, you know, unnecessary risks of your team dying. So she's definitely one of the best units you can use for B10 if you happen to have grabbed her last month during the event. The other units is like Water Persephone. She's probably the best if you happen to have her, but then again, she's a nat 5. There was an event a long time ago with the Dark Jack, but then, you know, they're not available anymore. I have worked towards a team that has, like, that basically is all tanky and uses sap against the boss. But even then, it's not all that reliable. I've heard of people using the Fire Cura because she's a shield-based healer, and then using a lot of other random monsters. What I recommend against B10 is mostly using aggressors. Aggressors make the run really, really stable because the units during the run hit very, very hard. I'll do a test run to show you guys my B10 run. I think this is probably the thing I showed the most out of like all possible runs. Aggressors are very, very good against B10 because they not only I think B10 is like a it's like a test of your overall monster's like power basically. You need to have high enough attack against these Dark Moon Flowers because they hit really, really hard if they use their second skill. So if you don't kill them within like the first turn, if you don't kill a few of them before they get their SP bar up to full, there's a lot of dangers of your team, like one of your teams dying when they all spam their nukes. So aggressors definitely do help in that sense. And you also, like, in case they spam their nukes, you need to be able to survive their nukes. So your monster need to be tanky, need to deal damage at the same time, and also be able to sustain through damage. It's basically just a test of your overall team's power. And in this sense, debuffs don't really matter. Like, you don't really need monsters that have utility, have debuffs, and stuff like that. You mainly just want monsters that are tanky and do high damage. So aggressors are definitely the key here. If you look at this team, there are four aggressors. They're all aggressors. This one's a defense aggressor. This one's a HP aggressor with a passive heal. This one's a HP aggressor. This one's a HP aggressor with an active heal. So this team is like super, super stable. Basically, there's no way that anyone can die. No way that I can ever fail this run, fail my goal in B10 runs while I'm using this team. And it's also relatively fast. It does this within 3 minutes. Compared to a lot of other people, it's probably not like super fast, but it's still, you know, with how stable it is, it's definitely really, really good. But I mean, for newer players, some of these monsters, like this one was with for Rebirth. Three of these monsters were for Rebirth. The Dark Miho was for Rebirth as well. The July was for Rebirth. The Cupid was just something I happened to have summoned. But if you have, like, for example, like three Dark, defense aggressors, like the next month, if you happen to get the Monkey, like, you know, two Dark Sea Stars, one Dark Monkey, and one like active shield healer that's built like really tanky, you should still definitely be able to clear through this. But it might be a little bit more risky without a passive healer. There's always a risk somewhere. So if you missed the Venus, if you missed all the events before, if you're not lucky enough to summon a Water Persephone, it's a lot harder. Like Golem's B10 is definitely going to be a lot harder. But although I don't really have a solution for you right now, it's not going to be a permanent situation because they always release really good monsters in events, so you just basically wait for the next like big event, and you'll eventually get some pretty good monsters that you can use for Golem's B10. So I wouldn't really worry too much about it. And even if you can't farm B10, you still have access to all the different types of gems from farming Golem's B7, 8, 9. You're not missing out too much there. But you know, Golem's B10 is definitely still worth farming because of how you get a higher chance to get 6-star gems if you're farming Golden's B10. So I've been talking for a long time, but I'm still not done yet. I'm still gonna keep going. All right. So the next step after Golden's B10 is you want to start working on dragons. Unfortunately, the dragon dungeon isn't open today, so I can't really show you guys the dragon dungeons, but I can talk about how to clear through the dragon dungeon. My recommendation for most people is to just basically stick with Golem's B10 farming for quite a while. You can go and clear through the highest level of dragon dungeon. You can farm stably, like maybe with just one refill, and you can do them every week for access to some gems. But it's also, in my opinion, it's kind of a waste of energy as well. You know, it's energies do cost stuff. Like, even though you're wasting dragon sigils, but if you're only farming the lowest of the lowest, you know dragons, then you don't have really good 6-star gems. My recommendation is to spend a lot of time in Goblin's B10, get the quality of your gems up, and then move directly, like, just go move straight into Dragon's B10. I am still in the process of making a perfect Dragon's B10 team, but I can stably do Dragon's B10 within 2 refills. Dragon's B10 is very, very hard. Basically, like, you have to manual the whole thing, and even when you manual it, you still won't 100% clear it. So a lot of times you have to refill for using your Astro Gems. Like, well, not refill, but like revive with your Astro Gems and continue doing the dungeon. But if you can do it within 2 refills, it's definitely worth it, because you're guaranteed a 6-star gem every single run. So it's definitely worth working on. For Dragon's B10, my strategy for Dragon's B10 is quite simple. I use the Dark Sea Star, Dark Gatito, Wood Gatito, and Wood Wild Fang. And Wood Wild Fang has 100% CC. She basically can always petrify and stun if you can get her to 100% crit rate. I have exactly 100% crit rate on her, so she's able to provide 100% CC on all units. And my Dark Gatito is basically just gemmed with lots and lots of attack. He just hits like a truck. Wood Gatito is also gemmed with a lot of attack. He also hits pretty hard. Dark Sea Star is there. She's gemmed pretty well. She's defense aggression, high defense, lots of damage. You know, pretty straightforward. The strategy is quite simple. I put in the Dark Sea Star as leader for the crit damage, and I just CC monsters with my Wood Wild Fang, and then I armor break with my Wood Gatito, who has 100% armor break, and then I one-shot monsters with my Dark Gatito, who hits like a truck. And I just use the strategy, I just CC monsters, stun them, and then kill the other ones that aren't CC'd. And then there's a little bit of RNG involved. I have to kind of hope that they attack my Dark Sea Star, because if they attack my Dark Gatito, who's built on full damage, he basically dies in one hit. But yeah, it's still a work in progress. I'm working on replacing my Sea Star and my Wild Fang with some other monsters. Recently just got that Light Medusa, who's going to be replacing my Wood Wild Fang. And also, I'm working on my Dark Victoria, who's going to be replacing my Dark Sea Star. So that's pretty much it for Golem's, or for Dragon's B10. Can't really show too much here, because I can't really actually do the runs. I'm definitely going to make a guide for Dragon's B10 once I get everything down and really, really stable. I'll make a guide for Dragon's B10. But after Dragon's B10, I think another thing you guys want to start working on is probably arena and clan battles, if you're able to do that. Clan battles and arena, these two things are something you want to work on, but you just kind of work on them on the side. Everything else I mentioned just now in this video is like, it's just a linear path to progression. But for arena and for PvP, Astromon League, and the clan battles, you just want to do as much as you can. Really, you don't really need to focus too much on clan battles and arena. You want to just do as much as you can with whatever limited monsters you have. I just did my clan battles, can't really show. It's pretty straightforward. You put in 16 monsters, you hit a boss, and he dies. Your clan all hit the boss, and he dies, and it gives you rewards. It's pretty simple. The best thing to use for clan battles is, like, three specific debuffs. You want Armor Break, Attack Down, and Blind. If you can land those on the boss, you put them on this team, they attack first. Land it on the boss, nuke with your second team, and rinse and repeat until you die. And that's pretty much it. You do as much damage as you can against the boss, and that's pretty much it. For Arena, you just want to use your best gemmed monsters for Arena. If you happen to be at the phase where you're doing B8 or B10 and you have some aggressors are also very, very strong for Arena. Aggressors are super OP in the game, like they're crazy strong, because they're tanky and they also hit hard, so it's like they have no real weakness. So yeah, abuse the shit out of aggressors if you happen to get them. And most of aggressors come from Rebirth, so everyone pretty much has access to them if you're actively farming monsters and doing Rebirth. Tower of Chaos is really something you want to work on the side as well. There's one day left. I probably should do this today, but I think I'll get to 450. Like there's 9 hours left. I'll do it for the Holy Gleam, and I think that's it. Like I'm too lazy to get to 470. Yeah, pretty much do the tower as far as you can for whatever rewards. They're also refreshing the tower next month to give better rewards, to actually like give Astro Gems and stuff. So definitely do the tower as much as you can. I kind of put it off until the last day. It's literally the last day today, so I'll work on that a little bit later. But yeah, that's pretty much it. I think I talked about everything. So it's been 46 minutes. I've been ranting on for a very, very long time, but hopefully this helped you guys out. And if you guys have any questions, definitely do ask me, and I'll be able to reply to you. I also have a Discord server. Like if you click on the description below, Discord is basically like a chat channel that I have for people that watch my YouTube. You know, it's a Discord server that I have open, and we talk about a lot of random stuff, mostly Monster Super League stuff on that channel. So you guys can definitely come hang out as well if you have any questions, or you can ask me, like not just me, but like other people as well who are, some people are actually further than me in the game, like they're more experienced in other, like they have different monsters, they have different perspective of the game. Because, you know, when you're so used to using the monsters that you have, you can't really, you don't really see how other people play the game. But if you're able to you know, get more perspective on people, especially people that happen to have the same type of monsters as you, because you know, not everybody's summoning luck is the same. Like I don't have a lot of really strong Nat 5s and stuff, but I did get some pretty crazy luck with my light dark summon, so I have some pretty strong light dark monsters. And I abuse the shit out of them. But that's, yeah, so everyone's luck is a little bit different. Everyone has leveled and worked on different monsters. So, you know, you guys can definitely come on my Discord and talk to random people. And that's pretty much it. And also, if you're new, you're looking for a clan to join, my clan's also open. We're accepting anyone. Like, there's no limit to... There's no requirement to join my clan, so if you guys want to join my clan, you can join my clan as well. Yeah, I linked my Discord here, and I'm not sure. I think we're almost full. We're one more player until we're full clan. I mean, we do have some people that aren't really contributing, but I'm too lazy to be a tryhard and like, you know, kick people and manage the clan. So if you guys want to come, then come, and that's pretty much it. That's the end of the video. Hopefully this helped you guys out, and hopefully you guys have some direction in the game. I'm going to continue farming now, and I'll see you guys in the next video. Peace out.